Ladies and gentlemen, please help us welcome Senior Pastor of Word of Life Christian Center in Honolulu, Hawaii, Pastor Art Sepulveda.
Who is Jesus? From everlasting to everlasting, he is God, the Bible says. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. In other words, the Word of God, the eternal God, became flesh in the person of Jesus Christ and lived like a man among us. He was God in the flesh.
I know God is all in us.
Tell me if you know someone that needs Jesus. Now we've been through a lot of things. Tell me if you know someone that needs Jesus.
Here's this passage that absolutely shocked the world. When Jesus read from Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he's anointed me. He's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me in this anointing to heal the brokenhearted. It goes on, in this anointing to proclaim liberty to the captives, in this anointing recovery of sight to the blind, in this anointing to set at liberty those that are oppressed, in this anointing to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Say the anointing. Say the anointing. Say I'm anointed to multiply.
Tell me if you know someone that needs
Jesus.
Aloha and yes, we are anointed to multiply. I want to say a great big aloha once again to Pastor Bert and Pastor Charnay Pretorius and the entire Pretorius family, and to all of the delegates there that are present at the G12 Africa Conference. I'm sure it's already been thrilling and exciting. Great revelation is coming, and I feel so privileged, Pastor Bert and Charnay, to be asked to be just a small part of this great conference. And once again, we are excited to be united as friends that go way back a number of years. And I just really, really value your input, your impact, not only in my personal life, but also in our church here in Hawaii, and how you are impacting also the nations of the world. Let's open up with a word of prayer for today. Father, we come before you in the mighty name of Jesus, and we thank that you would give each and every person present an understanding of what is ready to be unpacked and revealed by your Holy Spirit. Give us eyes to see your word as we've never seen it before, ears to hear your word as we've never heard it before, and a heart to receive your word with fresh insight and revelation. And we'll be sure to give you all the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to start in Psalms 126, and this is what it says. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongue was singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord hath done great things for them. The Lord hath done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Here the psalmist is speaking about the power of God to deliver them out of the prison house, so to speak, and now how they have been set free. It's a type and shadow, a story of the unveiling and revealing of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as it would be, not only was it there present, but also as it would be in the powerful name of Jesus, as you and I would now know as the New Testament. Once in captivity, now living in liberty. Once in prison and restricted and limited, away without God's presence, God's power, God's provision, and God's protection. Now all of that is available for them. And there's a great joy that they have. They have radically been changed by the power of the living God. You know, we were all held captive without God. It says in the book of Ephesians, without God and without hope in the world, until our eyes were open, our hearts were softened, and we received the Lord Jesus Christ into our personal life to totally transform us. We were held prisoner away from God's original pattern and plan and purpose for our lives. We were in captivity, so to speak, locked up, prisoned up, beat down, tore up from the floor up, as some people say, by a fallen angel who deceived Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Until the day of redemption, the cross of Calvary, the dividing line for humanity to come across one of the most powerful, powerful, powerful truths ever known to mankind. I'll get there in just a moment. But in Psalms 126, in the Passion Translation, it reads also like this. It was like a dream come true when you freed us from our bondage and brought us back to Zion. We laughed and laughed and overflowed with gladness. We were left shouting for joy and singing your praise. All the nations saw it and joined in saying, the Lord has done great miracles for them. Yes, he did mighty miracles and we were all overjoyed. Now, Lord, do it again. Restore us to our former glory. May streams of your refreshing flow over us until our dry hearts are drenched again. Like the psalmist said in a different place, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, he's talking about what God can do in life when they open up their hearts and live transformed. I love the idea because you and I, even today as I speak at this G12 Africa conference, were transformed. As it says here in Psalms 126, we were like them that dream. You have stepped into the dream of God for your life. Pastor Cesar once said, let's start with an undeniable and remarkable fact that we are all a product of a dream of God had in his heart. For we are his workmanship created in Christ. Oh, we're going to come back to that. We are the fruit of God's dream. Jesus opened the door so that you and I, those that are born again, no longer have to live captive, restricted, held back, or limited lives. He has changed us, and now we are to be living as a living epistle known and read by all men, a radically different life. We've come together, I believe, at this G12 Africa conference to be captured and recaptured by a very, very, very powerful dream, the dream of the Father's heart. Exactly right. The vision, the dream that the Father had imparted to Jesus, and then Jesus assigned it to not just some in the church, but to everybody in the church, the entire church, is called the Great Commission. You know, I like to communicate it this way. To be captured by the G12 vision is to be captured by the dream of the Father's heart. And to be captured by the dream of the Father's heart is to be captured by the Great Commission. To be captured means that there has to be a surrender, but in our case, it's a holy, willing surrender, a yielding to the Holy Spirit, a yielding to the love of God for us. And as that love is embraced in us, that love becomes a reality for others around us. It was Pastor Cesar who said, dream and you will win the world, of course. But he also went on to say, God can use you to awaken the spirit of those around you. You can help reproduce Christ in each of them and transform them into effective and uncompromising leaders until all humanity turns its face toward God. God is ultimately the only hope for the spiritual crisis in the world that we're facing. Church, we must awaken to see people to the dream of the Father's heart. That's why you're anointed to multiply. I want to talk to you about how you are anointed to multiply. It's not just a cute thematic phrase. It is the foundation for every believer that's born again, regardless what nation I may be speaking to or about, regardless on what language they may speak, and regardless of circumstances, color, or creed. You know, it was Paul the Apostle who began to unveil some things that I need you to get a hold of in the moments that I have with you. He said, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. You know, if you were to go up to the average person on the street and just say, do you know Jesus' last name? They would think for a moment and they'd say, oh, it's Christ, Jesus Christ. And that's not true. It is not his last name. I'm sure you know this. Because we need to understand what that word really means in your life. Not in just the general sense, but in your life. Let me unpack that just a little bit. Because once you begin to find out that what God's dream has been and now and the believer has come to pass, I believe there's going to be an awakening in your life to walk the way you've never walked, to expect the way you've never expected, to see the impossible things be turned into possibilities by the power of the living God and the anointing that lives on the inside of you. It's why the psalmist says, you know, our mouth is filled with laughter, our tongue is filled with singing. And that's why the heathen, the unchurched, the unsaved said, the Lord has done great things for them. You know, their countenance was filled with gladness and it was filled with great joy. So today, I want to talk to you about the reality of Christ in you. You know, in you, revealed in to us by the power of the living God. The reality of Christ is what Satan fears you'll take hold with confidence. He doesn't want you to understand that Christ in you. He doesn't want you to understand that no matter who you are, where you come from, what you're going through, you are anointed to multiply because you are anointed to live. See, the Bible reveals that it's the anointing that makes a difference in your life. It's the anointing that will make a difference in your family. It's the anointing that will make a difference in your marriage. It's the anointing that will make a difference with your children. It's the anointing that will make a difference in whatever career you might be about. But you must understand you are anointed to live. And because you're anointed to live, you are anointed to multiply. Now, most people don't understand that. They think it's just a cute little word, you know, that kind of identifies even though they say it with respect and with honor, their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But there's much, much more to that word. And it's why this theme, anointed to multiply, is so important for you to grab hold of and to live by. See, it's the anointing that matters. Without the anointing, we wouldn't make a difference. And until there's a difference, we can't make a difference in the world that needs a difference. You see, it's the difference the anointing is to the calling of God on your life, to the gifts that God has placed in your life. It's the difference to living creatively, powerfully, effectively, fruitfully, productively, and in great freedom. It's the message that Jesus Christ came with. It was in Luke chapter 4. You know, this is one of the most remarkable and important passages that most believers read over and read through and even know they're there and can even quote it, but have not gotten the revelation of it. So let's try to get some by the power of the Holy Spirit here with the moments that we have. It says in beginning in verse 17, Jesus was very specific and he says that he was handed a book by the prophet Isaiah. This is, of course, Isaiah 61 he's making reference to. And when he had opened the book, he found a place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and set at liberty them that are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And then he closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, sat down, and all the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. Why? They were baffled. They were astonished because he was identifying himself as the one that was spoken to come. But this my friends, is only part of your story. You see, Jesus came and gave clarity. Jesus came to remove confusion. Jesus came to remove hopelessness and powerlessness and aimlessness. And every believer needs to know how they are to live every day of their life, not just when they're in church, not just in their cell meeting, or just in their, you know, small gathering for a few hours, and then we live differently. I'm talking about how to live consistently every day of your life and powerfully, with knowing the Holy Spirit dwells in you and there's something bubbling up on the inside of you that can literally shake your nation. And this is so important for you and I to understand. In this passage, Luke chapter 4, it's Jesus who begins to state his mission. Jesus identifies himself as the anointed one that was prophesied in Scripture. He declared himself to all the world that he was the anointed one. They, knowing that, they heard that, they understood the Scriptures, that he was there to remove burdens and to destroy the yokes. And that's what the anointing means. Let me put this all together for you. Jesus states that this anointing is the good news that everyone's been waiting for. The anointing of the Holy Spirit that rested upon him is the power to remove burdens and destroy yokes. Now, I know how some of you are thinking, but follow me now. Track with me. Remember, Peter said in Acts chapter 10, verse 38, how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, and he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. The anointing on him was not just for him, but that anointing would work for him, through him, to reach a world around him. That's what you begin to read in Luke chapter 4. Now, Jesus ministered to his disciples concerning the anointing. It's why Peter declared, I believe it's Matthew 16, "Who do men," Jesus said, "who do men say that I am?" And it was Peter who answered after the others gave their insight. He said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus revealed then back to him, "Flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven." But when Peter said, "You are the Christ," what he was saying is what the word means to us in English. Christ in English means the anointed one. And you cannot talk about the anointed one without talking about the anointing. So he was the anointed one with an anointing, and the anointing defined, because of time here, to remove burdens and to destroy yokes. And so that's why when Peter said that, Jesus agreed with him. And Jesus began to preach about the anointing that was on him, that was going to come in those that would believe upon him after his resurrection. And it's so important because it's in Isaiah 10:27 that it's prophesied what this anointing would do. Now, I'm leading you somewhere. Stick with me now. It's in Isaiah 10:27, and Isaiah says, "And it shall come to pass in that day." What day? The day where Jesus was born of a virgin? Well, yeah, but that didn't happen for 30 years. He had to be anointed at the River Jordan first. For 30 years, it was at the River Jordan that the Holy Spirit came down and he was anointed there. That's where his miracle ministry began for the next 3 years thereabouts. But there's something even greater for you, church. You need to get a hold of this. But it goes on to say, "And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden," the devil's burden, "shall be taken away from off thy shoulder, and his yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing." Now, sometimes people think, well, that's only referring to Jesus. But it's not just referring to Jesus. It's referring to every born-again believer on every part of the world as we know it today. And this is the most powerful thing you can ever get a hold of. You see, what the Scriptures reveal, and I would encourage you when you have time to read the New Testament, Ephesians and the book of Colossians, because Paul's message to the entire Gentile church, to the entire church, was about the mystery What mystery, Pastor R? The mystery in Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. See, in God's wisdom, the Bible reveals in these passages, and there was a mystery hidden for ages and for generations until after the cross of Calvary. And so after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, no one knew about it. No one knew about it. And the Bible says, had the principalities and powers known, they never would have crucified the Lord of glory. But I'm here to tell you, it's a mystery that was hidden from ages and generations. But now, it says in Colossians chapter 1:26, has been revealed to the saints. But my gosh, the enemy is working hard that you would not have this revelation. He doesn't want you to have confidence that the anointing fits in your marriage, fits in your career, fits in your cell group, fits in your life. I'm here to tell you, it does. It is so important because without it, we are just like everybody else. We're just like everyone else, working and laboring with our skill base naturally. Nothing wrong with that. But there's a factor that makes a difference. It's called the anointing. The anointing to live and the anointing to multiply. Let me help you to understand this just a little bit more. Colossians 1:27 goes on to say, to them, God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of his mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, this was Paul's assignment. If you go back and read Ephesians chapter 3, you'll find out he talked about the mystery, the mystery, the mystery. The Bible's not a mystery. The mystery once covered has now been revealed. The dividing line is the cross of Calvary. The dividing line is not, you know, pre-Calvary. It's post. It's important for you and I to understand when he rose from the dead and you and I had the opportunity to receive him into our life. Yes, we were born again, not to become religious, not to become a spiritual, just talking individual that has no power. But the Bible says that the anointing abides within you permanently. In 1 John 2:20 and 27. But here he reveals it very clearly that the mystery is Christ. Now, if you were to do a little bit of a study, you'd find out that that word Christ is found 341 times in your Bible. But you see, the translators that originally translated it didn't translate it accurately. They translated it conservatively. Now, you have to understand that the Bible is an Eastern book. And when people read it according to the actual language from Hebrew to Greek, they'll begin, and in English, at least in the English language, what the word Christ means is anointed one and his anointing. So this is why you need to learn to translate and meditate. Translate and meditate. If you're going to get this, you're going to have to learn to translate. So everywhere in the New Testament, you see the word Christ. If you just put an identity point right there, you'll find out that if you were to put the actual meaning in English, because I presume you're reading in English, for those of you who do read in English, you'd be seeing 341 times at minimum. The anointed one and his anointing. The anointed one and his anointing. The anointed one and his anointing. That's why when Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ, it'd be like saying, follow me as I follow the anointed one and his anointing. Now, he's not just using that because it's his last name. He's using that to understand who you are in Christ, who lives inside of you. You know, it's in Romans chapter 8. Verse 11 that says that the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead, dwells in you and quickens your mortal body. The anointed one dwells in you, and the same burden-removing, yoke-destroying power of God dwells in you. This is why you're anointed to live. This is why, not a cute little phrase, you're anointed to multiply. Because there's that God factor on the inside of you. There's that God factor when you and I get a hold of it. You're anointed to multiply. And it's so important. I'm going to pick up something that it talks about in the book of Ephesians chapter 3, just a portion of it. before I move on. For this reason, I, Paul, verse 1, the prisoner of Christ Jesus for you Gentiles, verse 2, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of grace of God, which was given to you, verse 6, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and partakers of his promise, the anointed one and his anointing. Not just so you can identify yourself, yes, as a believer, yes, as a Christian, yes, as a saved person, but to walk with the anointed one and his anointing, which is to remove burdens and destroy yokes. It goes on to say that this comes through the gospel. Verse 10 goes on to say, now that the manifold wisdom of God, in other words, that which was once hidden has now been revealed. It says, now that the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, to make all see what is the fellowship and the mystery of Christ. Powerful, powerful, powerful. And I wish I had time to share more about that. But you are anointed to multiply as you are anointed to live. And you are anointed to live. Therefore, your confidence ought to be you're anointed to multiply. Now, I know walking, you know, things out requires some specific attributes, but it's with the anointing. You ought to be doing nothing without confidence in the anointing. Nothing. And it's important. This is what Paul was talking about. In the Amplified Bible of Philippians chapter 4, verse 12, I'll just make reference to it. Paul reveals that he had to learn a secret. And the secret that he talks about in verse 12, he says, is the secret that in facing anything and all things or all circumstances, he learned the secret. And that was, he can do all things through Christ, the anointed one, and his anointing that empowers him. Now, he wasn't just trying to fill space. He was trying to, by the Holy Ghost, these are words that the Holy Spirit is using a yielded vessel called Paul the Apostle to pin things down so that you and I, some thousands of years later, can get hold of the revelation and live by him. And this is the key. Paul had to learn this. In other words, he was operating it, but he had to learn some things, that the key to his life was the anointing. The anointed one and his anointing to remove burdens and destroy yokes. He says, so it doesn't make a difference where I'm at, what I'm going through. I know that the anointed one and his anointing will make a difference. If you go back and read that in context, you'll get some great insight. Every believer is anointed to live, and every believer is anointed to multiply. So why do some people not get certain results at certain times in their life? Because of two things that I can only mention. I don't have much time to go into right now. But number one, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 19 to 20, and you could just read that whole chapter, 1 John actually, he talks about how the Antichrist spirit is coming, referring to the beast found in the book of Revelation. But he says also there are many Antichrists that come to seduce you, to deceive you. Antichrist behavior. I want you to get a hold of this. We must fight against these Antichrist behaviors and another factor, something called unholy alliances. Ooh, Jesus, I wish I had time. These are the little foxes that spoil the vine. See, the Bible is like a roadmap that shows you how to pay attention so that you can live in the anointing in your family, in your personal life, but also how you can live with the expectation and the revelation that you've been anointed to multiply. And it's not difficult, but we do got to guard our heart. The Bible says, John said, little children, there are many antichrists. Well, he wasn't talking about many beasts that were coming down the road as in the book of Revelation, but he was talking about those things that tend to quench and to hinder and to blind, to block, to stop the anointing of God from operating or working in your life on a daily basis. I'm talking about things like unforgiveness and lying and gossip and backbiting and discord and divination and division, offense and strife, to name a few, lasciviousness, sin, impurity, anger, lying, selfishness, bitterness, immorality, unbelief, fear, carnality, et cetera, et cetera. These things come to seduce us, to blind us, to hinder the anointing. This is why you got to guard your heart with all diligence. See, it's important that you and I understand. But if you go back and you read in verse 1 John 2, 26, 27, you'll begin to see the anointing which you have received abideth in you. In another version, it says permanently. See, the enemy's always trying to hinder you and I, distract us from how we are to live. See, here's the big question. Who is willing to pay the price to do the things to keep the anointing working in their lives? The attacks of the adversary today are all about stopping the anointing in your life, stopping you from living a life that multiplies. Oh, he'll bring about temptations and he'll bring about distractions, but the anointing will destroy the yokes. It's important that you and I understand that we must not allow any antichrist spirit seduce or hinder, taint or contaminate, quench or block the anointing that God paid a price through his son so that you and I can not only have it deposited in us, but live life powerfully. And then there are these things called unholy alliances. An alliance is an association or connection or an agreement or some form of pact that's uniting your life to something that embraces any unholy antichrist behavior or attitude. An alliance, people that are toxic, an alliance, things that you've come in agreement with. I'm here to tell you, unholy alliances are the most dangerous thing that you can get involved with. So here's what I want you to understand. Not only are you anointed to live, but you're anointed to multiply. The mystery has been revealed. The question is not with the anointed one and his anointing. There's an anointing on your life. If you are born again, washed by the blood of the Lamb, and you believe in the power of the living God, I'm here to tell you today the dividing line for the best of your life to live the dream of the Father's heart, not only for yourself, but think about how you can impact and change cities and townships or wherever you come from. Environments, because not just because of you on the outside, it's because of who's living on you on the inside. And I'd like to give you a little bit of an insight here of an individual who came from a very, very, very dark background. This is what the power of the anointing will do. This person began to live out a dream where they're now impacting the higher court systems, part of the G12 vision, part of making a difference in people's lives. I'd like this person to share their story. And once they're done, I'm going to pray for you that a greater understanding will come to all of us in the church concerning how we are anointed to live and anointed to multiply. Watch this.
I was 27, I found myself trapped in a life of sex trafficking. Not knowing where to go to, who to turn to, I just started spiraling down in a whirlwind of darkness. It wasn't until I found myself in the hospital in the ICU for over a month. Doctors said all my vital organs started shutting down because of the extreme physical abuse that I endured. My kidneys were failing, my heart was slowing down, but every day my daughter, who was six at the time, would come bedside with my grandmother, and my daughter at 6 years old would put the anointing oil on my forehead and pray for me. The doctors basically told my family to come and say your goodbyes. We don't know what else to do. There was one last hope that the doctor wanted to do, which was cut me open and put a pacemaker in my heart. And the night before surgery, suddenly my blood tests started progressing just a tiny bit, but the doctor said, hey, let's take a look at this again in the morning. He didn't seem to have much hope still. However, in the morning, it was continuing to show progress. So he ended up canceling the surgery. By the end of the week, I was discharged fully from the hospital. No surgery was needed. There's no explanation as to what the turnaround was medically. The doctors to this day can't explain why my organs started working again. I know in my heart that it was because of the women that were praying for me, the people that were praying for me. After I got out of the hospital, I went home with my family to try to recover, and they welcomed me back in their home. There was a time where my family decided they wanted nothing to do with me. I wasn't there a week, and the pimp came, took me out of the house, and the vicious cycle started all over again. It wasn't until 2010 in Miami at the Super Bowl, there was a tip put in, and the Miami police was able to recover myself and three other females. The pimp was then arrested, eventually convicted and sentenced to 22 years in federal prison. It was from that night I was able to come back to Hawaii and really start anew. Again, I didn't know who to turn to, where to go. There were no resources. Definitely, I felt no one would understand where I'm coming out of, what my life was like. I was completely destroyed from the inside out. Coming out of a lifestyle where being raped and abused was normal. Deep down, I knew, because I was raised in the church, it was in that moment where I decided it's time to go back to the house of God. My daughter and I, we came to Word of Life, and I remember coming here when I was a child, and I always felt at home. There's a story in the Bible that talks about the woman with the issue of blood. That was me. This woman bled for 12 years, but I understood it as blood equivalated pain, and that was me. I endured a lot of pain, a lot of trauma. Doctors diagnosed me with extreme PTSD. They said I could never function the same. So coming into Word of Life, I came in with that hunger, that desire, as that woman did, that yearning, that knowing that if I just touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. I will be made whole. And I knew it. I believed it. I felt it. And just as that woman touched the hem of his garment, I truly believe God felt it when I went to the altar, because that was my desperation. That was my surrender. Like, God, I don't know how I'm gonna get healed, but I know that you can do it. I don't understand it, but I know that you will do it. I believe as he turned to the woman, he turned to me and said, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Now go in peace. And that's what I did. And that is when I was able to surrender my life. It was from that point I was plugged in with pastors, leaders at our church. My daughter and I started attending life groups. We would be here every time the doors were open. I just wanted to be in the house of God. I wanted to be planted, surrounded by Christians. This was my family. Even during that season, my daughter got taken away from me. Because of my affiliation, we continued to persevere through that hard season. You know, people think that when you become a Christian, your life is perfect, but that's when you have to be ready, be prepared, stay war ready, because it is a spiritual battle that we fight. And that surely is what I had to learn to conquer every day in my thoughts, in my heart, in my life. When past memories try to come up, rebuke it in the name of Jesus. When hardships would come up, I no longer needed swear words when I had the Word of God, the truth of God to sustain me in every moment. I started having life groups and ministering to women in transition that I was able to be there with them. A lot of women were going through custody battles, getting their children back. And I was in that season of, Lord, I'm ministering to people and I don't even have my daughter back yet, you know? And he showed me the strength that I was able to gain through those weakest moments of my life, that as you continue to be obedient and put your hand to the plow, I got you, I will bless you. It wasn't too long later that I was able to gain custody of my daughter back. My relationships with my family, who once upon a time disowned me, welcomed me. We have great relationships now, and it's only by the grace of God. Only God can soften the hardest hearts. Through that season, that is what really set my foundation as a woman of God. You know, taking a step by faith, trusting. I'm walking in my purpose now, that God turned my mess into a message. And sure enough, God continued to open those doors. I started sharing my story with law enforcement. I started being asked to speak at different events, engagements. I am now with the Department of the Attorney General, the Missing Child Center. I have the honor of working with every law enforcement agency to recover missing and exploited children. I'm also federally recognized and am able to be on those platforms, but really I'm there to be a light for Jesus. I recently had the honor of being part of the core team to lead Hawaii's first initiative of Operation Shine the Light. We want these missing children, these young people that are classified as runaways, to know that they're not forgotten, that we're looking for you, that we care about you, we love you, we want you to be safe and whole. And to see the success that happened because of those efforts, the recoveries that we were able to make, it just continued to lead to one thing to another. God continues to open doors that no man can shut. Most recently, I had the opportunity by the Department of Defense to share a story, share my story, share on human trafficking. But the heart of it all was to share how Jesus transformed my life. And this story is housed at the Library of Congress. So generations to come will be able to hear not just about the topic of human trafficking, but the story of Jesus and what truly healed me, who truly healed me, how I was able to move forward. And that's legacy. And that's the type of vision that God continues to give me, that God gives us through the G12 vision. If it wasn't for Word of Life, if it wasn't for this vision, I wouldn't be planted. I wouldn't have that strong foundation, you know, that edification of the Word. It is only the meat, right? The meat of the Word of God that feeds me, that sustains me, that helps me through every battle, everything, no matter how big or how small. Pain is real, but hope is greater. And now together as a family, my daughter and I are able to run with the vision together, this G12 vision. My daughter is planted in a life group. I'm in a life group. I have a life group. I'm a 144 leader. And because of this, we are able to do this together. To see my daughter minister to daughters of women in transition, there's no words to describe what that means, to now see my daughter doing the same thing. And I'm just forever thankful for our pastors, Pastor Art and Pastor Kuna, all the pastors and leaders here, continuing to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, continuing to be that extension of love. Only God can heal and restore a broken heart. He completely transformed my life. gave me a brand new start, and I am forever grateful for Jesus.
Did you hear that powerful testimony of Kaleigh Grant? My gosh, she's making a difference. She's turned her entire life around because of the Anointed One and the anointing that she has residing inside of her. No different for you. You see, we have to be careful because, as Paul once said, "But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted," or contaminated is what that word corrupted mean, or tainted or polluted, "from the simplicity that is in Christ, the Anointed One, and his anointing." And then he goes on in verse 4 of 2 Corinthians chapter 11 to say, when people come to you with another gospel, with another Jesus, and with another spirit, the beauty of the power of the blood is something the writer of the book of Hebrews once said, and this refers to Kaleigh Grant, that he is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him. I once heard a preacher say that God is able to save from the guttermost, and that's where Kaleigh Grant was, to the uttermost. I'm here to tell you, my friends, it is no different for you. If you're born again, you're anointed to live, and you're anointed to multiply. The best days are not behind you. The best days are right in front of you. I need you to lock in, grab hold, study out the word, and realize who you are now in Christ, the Anointed One, and his anointing. Let me pray for you. Father, I come before you in the name of Jesus. What a privilege it is to have these few moments with my friends, with Pastor Bert, Pastor Charnay, and the entire family there. All the delegates, Lord, I pray for a fresh understanding upon everyone's life that is heeding this word, whether they've just been born again recently or have been seasoned for a number of years. Father, give us a fresh insight. Lord, I pray today that we would once again dream the dream of the Father's heart. And no matter where you've called us, Father God, to work and to labor, in the natural, Lord, that anointing abides in us to make a difference, to influence people's lives by the power of the living God. Lord, I pray that you would give people insight. And we come against every antichrist attitude. We reject it, cast it down in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We thank you, Father God. We break every unholy alliance that would try to come against us. We do not make secret covenants with anything that is unholy and hindering the anointing of God, not even for a moment. Lord, may you find our hearts surrendered. May you find our hearts in humility before you as we call upon the mercy of God, your goodness, oh God. I know you want, Father God, all at this conference and across the world with your church, the body of Christ, the Anointed One and his anointing, to rise up with a new confidence, with a new expectation, and to live life purposefully. That the anointing, Father, is not just for chosen few, but for the entire family of the living God. Thank you once again for the work of your Holy Spirit. Thank you once again for ministering, Father God, to each and every person. Thank you once again, Father God. There's great joy and laughter that fills our hearts. And may the unchurched see the goodness of God in our lives and say, my God, what God has done in their lives, the turnaround he has done. And Father, that would give us an opportunity to share the good news of Jesus Christ, the Anointed One and his anointing with them. We love you, Lord. We thank you once again for bringing us together in Jesus' mighty name. Aloha, my family. We'll see you real soon. Thank you, Pastor Bert. Thank you, Pastor Charnay. You're forever our covenant friends. And from the family of Word Life Christian Center here in Honolulu, Hawaii, we love you. God bless.